Jackson, standing close to him, dropped like a stone as Barclay shouted that, a hole appearing in the very centre of his forehead, his hat flying off as he jerked backwards to splay on the deck, arms and legs outstretched. There was no doubting his condition. "A message to the second lieutenant, too, boy. He is to take over from the Premier, who is killed." There were bodies all over the quarter-deck and fore-deck, but if Semele was being pounded, the enemy was suffering more. For the main-deck carronades had already removed the bulkheads opposite, and were now firing huge balls across the open deck, seeking to blast the mainmast at its base. The mid had disappeared with his message, running down to the dim, red-painted main-deck to deliver. The guns were already loaded and run right up to the ports, which only had to be hauled up, the problem being that they would not move more than 6 inches before they struck on the side of the enemy tumble-home, and heave as they might, the gun crews could do no more. The order to belay and fire regardless took a moment to sink in, but the crew on Davy's cannon, of which he was the captain, Charlie and Rufus included, leapt to the restraining tackles as he yelled they should do. Once they were set, feet splayed to restrain the recoil, he pulled the lanyard and set off the flint. All along the deck the same thing was being acted out, and the ports before them splintered and disintegrated as they were smashed by the great solid 32-pound rounds of iron. More gratifying was that those same balls, at such close range, demolished the scantlings on the Vengeur du Peuple, reducing the outer layer to matchwood, and in a couple of cases exposing the carpenter's walk. Even better, where they met an opposing gunport, they went through the thinner wood with enough force to dismount the enemy cannon, evinced by the loud clanging and the screams which overbore the boom of blasted powder, though smoke made it impossible to see what bloody turmoil had been inflicted.